Late night lover, you know, the one that swings like no other. I got a lot of things I need to explain, but baby, you know the name, and love is about pain. So stop the complaints and drop the order of restraint. Our sex life's a game, so back me down in the paint. I can't wait no more. This is about a quarter past three, and sure days I mean, I got the Bentley Ballet, and I'm just outside of Jersey, past the Palisades, and I love to see that. Hoops and shades, spread out on the bed while I'm yanking your braids. Thug style, you never thought I'd make you smile while I'm smacking you all while. But we share something so rare, but who cares? You can, baby.
I'm not always there when you call, but I'm always on time, and I gave.
Come on, pull it together. It's only a sun shower. We've been through worse weather like that. Stormy night, you wrote a dear child letter and took my Benz and keyed and cut the leather. You know better. Either M-O-B, money or murder, I-N-Z. I got two or three for every V, and I keep you up off that. I'm a playground legend like Kirkland Pee-wee. They my in the league, got more game than me. I play harder, so many women I bothered. Meet them with scars and sit them home hot and bothered. Truth to dare, this life ain't apparently fair. Ain't a love with no glare, is a crystal stare. But we share something so rare. But who cares? You can, baby.
I'm not always there when you call, but I'm always on time. And I gave
Vendetti's block once again. Got my guest Steve Lindsay.
What's up, Joker? How you doing?
Bird EOM. What's going on?
What's going on? What's going on?
There he is.
It's been a long road. I've known both of you guys for a long time. I mean, pretty much since the business, you know, VSOP-MEGA. And I mean, you were there for the first shows, like LG. Just, I mean, the good and the bad. Steve, you want to enlighten people on what you do?
Yeah, absolutely, man. I am a counselor, therapist at Midwest Life Center, and you catch that at midwestlifecenter.com. Also, a DJ, do that six nights a week, and then I have a children's show that I do. It's called the Royal Pirates of Tortuga, and there we stress family values on that. Actually, it's pretty cool, man, because we're talking about with the kids, the self, the second dynamic, the family, right, which we're going to be discussing today. Third, groups, five, and animals. We have a parrot that we use. And then we also
Zazu.
Do the Zazu. That's it. And as a matter of fact, you know, just as a note, Zazu just had an egg, so it's a girl.
Are you serious?
We're calling her Zazie now, man.
That's tight.
Last week.
Maybe that's why he was so moody last week. Whenever he was acting kind of shady, he was just like
the parrot.
No joker.
Yep.
No joker. I'm like, man, I've been there for years, man, years. Oh yeah, good to have you.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, so we're talking about family dynamics. Just, I mean, because, you know, we talked last week about violence and gun control, and then we touched a little bit on, you know, dynamics of the family, but I wanted to get more in depth of, you know, what exactly, how it is now, where it was, and, you know, the future of it, and how we can, like, get a roadmap designed to where we can change how we think about family dynamics, because I think the way now there's a lot of, it's not really there, you know, it's like people have kids and it's just like, you know, the parents usually become enemies and they're, you know, combative, and it's, there's not really a, I would say, a desire for a lot of people to even, you know, be a family and what it really entails and dedicate what it really takes, because it takes a lot of sacrifice.
It takes a lot
of discipline, you know, and I think just where we come with all this technology and all this, we just become this lackadaisical in our way of thinking about this kind of stuff, because, you know, from you just go on your phone and you can do anything. You can go on the internet and find stuff, and we're so distracted. We don't think about, you know, the time we spend with our families and how we, you know, get those values. So we're going to start with the family structure, because, I mean, you're from another generation, and I know how, well, that wasn't expected, but this is Vendetti's block.
This is Vendetti's block, yes.
Though the family structure, the mother figure, I mean, you know, the father figure, then the siblings, the extended family, and I call it the village, which is the neighborhood.
Right.
You know, they say it takes a village to raise a child.
Yeah.
You know, as far as I, you know, can see right now, there's hardly any village. You know, there's, you know, extended family and siblings, but there's a lot of, I mean, I know people that are cousins, like, gang, and they fight, like, it's, there's
scrapping.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Over colors and not, you know, anything that's, you know, of any substance, really.
Right.
When it's your family, I mean, but the past, how things used to be, it seems like, you know, your mom, you could always talk to your mom if you had, you know, if you had a mom that was there, she usually was, you know, mother bear, you know, dad was like the reinforcing guy.
Right.
If you got a line, you know what happened, you know?
Right.
And, you know, there were certain things that a father would pass down to a son, you know, and like certain, you know, like he would talk to him about women. He would talk to him about, you know, this and that, you know, the game.
Right.
He would put him on game, you know. That doesn't happen anymore, really.
It doesn't.
It's, you know, the siblings used to be like, you couldn't mess with somebody's, you couldn't call somebody sister a hoe.
It was on like Donkey Kong,
right,
if you
in
will.
The mouth. You couldn't talk about somebody's mom.
Yeah.
You couldn't, like,
right?
You know, it's like you couldn't disrespect family. But now it's just like, I mean, there's artists that make raps about their parents just dissing them, like.
I know, man.
You know, it's.
That's part of it right there, Joker. I mean, that, see, the whole thing is with that family, man, I mean, that is supposed to be strong. You know, and you were talking about the technology and stuff like that. Anymore, they, you know, they babysit the kids. Here's an iPad.
Right.
I ain't talk to you. I'm going to go in here and, you
exactly.
know, talk to Carol on the phone, my best friend from, you know. No, that child, you know, especially coming up, man, they need that structure. They need that love, man.
And they need to be engaged with.
Big time.
Like family type situations. There's,
yeah, man.
I mean, my family, we, you know. my mom was adamant about being a, you know, being a family, and she's pretty much what kept it together.
Right. Like, yeah, I met your family. They're very cool.
Yeah.
Man.
And, you know, because I'm like my dad. Like, he's hard to deal with. I'm hard to deal with. That's why I, you know.
I don't think you're hard to deal with.
I'm friends with him. It's like, I am a hard man to deal with.
All right.
You know? And it would take a special kind of woman to deal with me. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. So, but,
that's any man.
Yeah.
Right?
But, you know, me and my dad's relationship, and even with my brother, it wasn't really, you know, like the ideal father-son relationship. But I knew for a fact that if I didn't do what my mom said, I guess it'd be coming, you know what I'm saying?
Pops would be coming. Smackdown. Yep, and Pops would be coming through the door.
So, you know, even though there was some things lacking, it was like, it still was a balance there. It was still, because, you know, there was, if my dad wasn't there, I would have rebelled against my mom. Mm-hmm. Like, no doubt. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I absolutely, like, you know, fathers need to be there. Mm-hmm. If people can work it out, they need to.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I just feel like that. Even if they're not together, they need to be friendly. Mm-hmm. And then the kids need to see that they're friendly. And that they're, you know, I mean, when you were growing up, I mean, I like, the stuff that's going on now is probably unheard of.
Oh, totally unheard of, man. You would never talk to your family like that. You'd never talk to your dad like that. If I see these kids talking to their parents, and they throw out an F-bomb right in front of their parents, I'm like, man, right, my dad would have beat my butt. Like, I mean, man, yeah. And I mean, come on. I mean, you know, and so it's your respect. But here's what I think that, you know, I mean, this is just part of it. I'm not going to get way deep into it. But, you know, when you have a mother and father together, right, and you have a child, if I say a valance, that would be a personality that the other person takes on. So the child always takes the winning valance. It doesn't make any difference. The mom could be, you know, cutting the dad down verbally, and the dad cowers. And guess what? That child picks up, right? That verbal language. Or if he sees the dad, unfortunately, and it's sick to see, hitting the mom, that child, he's still going to take the winning valance on. That's just what he does.
And he thinks, right? It's okay.
And, yeah. You know? And so the mom and dad, man, they got to be tight, bro. They got to be tight.
They got to be a team.
They got to be a team. And that kid can go like this, yeah, yeah, I want to be like that. You know, that kind of thing. That's what we need, man. You know? We need the family to tighten up. There's a song called Tighten Up.
I think the times,
right?
Me personally, I think the times have, they changed so much, you know, because women these days is just like, oh, I'm so independent. I can do this by myself. I don't need you. My child needs a dad. How much I need a father? You know?
Yeah.
So I just feel like so much has changed.
And society's done that, man. Exactly. Big time, my friend. Absolutely.
You know? So it makes it more difficult for, you know, for a father to try to be a father.
Yep.
Especially when.
Oh, man, it's.
Yeah.
You. It's crazy. More than, you know, just trying. Like, in the 80s, if you had a baby mama, if you just came around, dude, straight up, and, like, bought diapers and, like, you know, just, like, even if you just half-heartedly participated, like, they were happy.
It was very appreciative.
They were appreciative. Like, right. Now it's like,
I don't need that. I mean, why'd you bring that around? It's like, I'm just trying to help.
That's when I got to the present family, you know, how things are presently. And, you know, and it's, you know, mother figures, and that's what you were talking about, the government entitlements. And it's so easy for them to tell the dad to go to hell. It's like, I don't need you. I get food stamps. Yeah. I get this. I get, you know.
And just because.
I get child care. I get, you know.
I mean, and food stamps are there to help, you know, and
right.
Not to take advantage of, right? So you still got to be responsible, and the child's going to pick that up, too.
I agree.
You know?
And, I mean, when it comes to dads, I'm not going to lie. I mean, there's, like, a lacking sense, sometimes it's non-present. I know cats that, I'm like, you have kids? Like, I've known them for years. And I mean, I feel like if you've known somebody for a long time, even if you do business, the family man will always come out. Sometimes you know that they have a family, you know that they have kids, you know that they're like a dad,
Mm-hmm. You know? Exactly. We was at the hospital together.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. And now I know some cats and I'm like, you know them for a couple of years. I see them at the bar, you know, and just mm-hmm. like, and I'm like, damn, you're a dad? Oh, snap.
Right, right. And Joker. And, uh-oh. And here's the thing, you guys, you know, and like I think I said it last week too, but I DJ, you know, and I see it on the front lines.
Right, that's what I'm talking about.
The total you? Front lines, man, and you can see a degradation of society, man, because when people used to go out, they used to go out to have fun. Now, if we went back like in the 50s, everybody was dressed to a T when they went right. out. I don't even care if it was like, you know, they went out to... I don't know, to dance or something like that. You know, they were wearing suits.
They were nice snap. With the Burger King.
Right, you know exactly, man.
We're going to that new Burger King.
Yeah, let's go. You know, absolutely. You know, and the mentality, you know, now is like, you know, it's very abrasive and it's a lack of respect, you know. And you've seen it out there, Joker.
I see it all the time.
You know, when they come up and ask for me for a song, man, it's like they just pow, you know, and just... It's when it's more of a forceful ask than it is a, hey man, could you please play this? And of course I will. You know I will. I'm like that.
Yeah.
But now it's like, man.
Is I don't know where fighty. That went, but it seems like you're a pussy if you're like polite. And
right.
if you're a gentleman.
And.
You know, and I'm like, but to me, that's gangster. Like mm-hmm. you, if you, you know, if you hold a door open for a woman, you know, chivalry.
That's what's.
I mean, it is pretty much dead. But I mean, I'm not gonna lie. Women helped kill it. I mean, with all this slutty attire that.
Oh, you know, well,
all the
yeah.
clothes and you know, and that's another thing. Like the mother figures with, like. I'll go to the store and I'll see a chick with her kids and I'll see what she has on. It's just like, why are you dressed like a hoe?
Mm-hmm. Or the why do you look better than your kid?
Right, that too. Oh my God, hair done.
Look at that.
And then
yeah.
naps on the kid.
Right.
Big ass shirt, you know, that's you know, or too yeah. small, and you know, raggedy shoes. I'm just like,
yeah, and that starts with the parents having a respect for themselves, mm-hmm. a healthy one.
Right.
You know, but it's like that contagion of aberration. They gonna do what they saw, you know, coming up, and then this person's gonna do what they saw, and it just keeps going.
Ripple effect.
Well, that's what
yes,
happened.
Absolutely, man.
I was thinking you go from the 70s to the 80s to the 90s. And I think from the mid 80s to, and I think we pretty much lost it around, you know, 2003, 2004, 2005. Mm-hmm. You know, it just downhill.
Yep. And you saw it too. Absolutely, Joker. For
and
sure.
There was my brother had a friend growing up. Mm-hmm. It was one of his best friends. And he had a little brother too, so sometimes I'd go spend the night on the weekends, and I was literally appalled because their dad was deaf, mm-hmm. and so they always had the sign.
Mm-hmm.
So you would not believe what they would say to the mom. You know,
oh,
dad couldn't hear.
Dad couldn't hear.
Like, she'd have to sit there and explain
man.
What they just said. You know, and it was really, but he wasn't really like a disciplinary figure, and I just saw how that was just mm-hmm. like it just totally destroyed the. Level of respect they had for their mom, they had none.
Yeah.
They just spit on the wall. I mean, yeah, you know, really disgusting behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, but that was rare then
mm-hmm.
to have that situation. Now it's common.
Mm-hmm.
So how can we, you know, get back to where, I mean, I'm not saying we got to totally change. You know, we can't change the world, but there's these little things, if you just become aware of them,
mm-hmm.
you know, I was aware that I was coming off to my son's mom in a way that seemed like sometimes tyrannical with like demand because like I felt entitled, like if I'm doing this, then I should be able to, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't, we never really had a conversation. And then it got to the point where I think where she just got so pissed off at me, she just had this image of me that still burned into her head.
Mm-hmm.
And it's hard for, you know, the relationship with my son. And I have to like go the extra mile to make sure, like to check on him,
mm-hmm.
you know, I always got an eye on him. He goes to the same elementary school I went to down the street and everything.
Mm-hmm.
He runs around here like I used to when I was his age. So, I mean, I got eyes on him, but if I didn't, I'd be like scared to death all the time because I didn't know what was going on. I mean, but it's like, I mean, we figured out it's just always better just to try to get along.
Absolutely.
Because time just passes, and then eventually then the kid's like 14, 15, right. You know, you've missed out on all this time that could have been, you know, time is unforgiving. It's mm-hmm. not coming back. Like, so that moment in these kids' lives when they're 10, 11, 12, getting to their formative years, and they're, mm-hmm. you know, they're about to hit puberty and their hormones start going haywire, you know, it's important for them to have support, and they know they have support, mm-hmm. and they don't want to have to, like, oh, I could tell dad this, but I don't want mom to know. Right. Because that's not cool.
Right.
You know, it should be on an even keel.
Absolutely. And, you know, I think going through that as well, you know, there's good control and there's bad control.
Right.
Right. Now, no control is bad control.
Exactly.
It is, man. So there's good control. And, you know, if I can, I'm going to just go there. You've got three methods of control. Enhancement, invalidation, and domination. Right? So enhancement would be like this. Joker, man, those glasses look good. Man, yeah. My man over here has got those tags on. That looks, that's all right, man. You look good. I mean, for real. It looks good. Right? And then you have invalidation, right? And I don't mean this when I say this. I mean, you'd be like, I don't know why you're wearing that hat, you know? Yeah. That's invalidation.
Exactly.
And some people throw it in, and the parents will do that to the kids, man. They don't enhance them. They invalidate them. You know, they make these little underhanded, sarcastic comments. They know that. And then you have domination, and this goes all around, man. It'd be like, well, man, you know, if you don't call me, then I'm not going to love you anymore. And that's heavy, right. You know. But that's outright domination. Or, I mean, you see it where I'm at, you know, at night, you know, you see it in the bars, you know, if you don't play this, man, something's going to go down. It's like, dude, don't try and dominate me like that. Just ask me. You know?
Have I ever been there or something like that? Like, oh, holler at Joker. He'll know.
Yeah. And I just, when they do that, I go, okay, I'll get that as soon as I can for you, man. Yeah, just look at him like that. You know, and just give him some love. So enhancement, that's the best way to do it, man. You know, the little girl, you know, that does something great in the house. Or maybe she just cooks an egg or something. Sally, that was awesome. Man, can you do another one? Holy mackerel. You know. So we'd have enhancement, invalidation, and domination. Enhancement. We operate on that.
Well, yeah. And that's, I think, it's, some of it is how you're raised, but a lot of it's not. I was just talking to she's like my brother. Like, we've gone through a lot. You know, mm-hmm. we've known each other for almost 30 years. Mm-hmm. So his son is like 18, my nephew, and he, you know, he's a handful. He's a good kid, though. I mean, mm-hmm. he's a black belt. But I mean, I think for growing up in this time, he's doing really well.
Mm-hmm.
But he still has that lack of respect for his dad.
Okay.
Yeah, and he doesn't understand that, why, where he gets that rebellious, and why he's, because he's done everything for the kid. The kid doesn't have to do anything, really.
Right.
I told him when he was 14 years old, I was like, you don't screw up, you got it made. I was like, you got people out here.
Mm-hmm.
You can do, you'll be able to go wherever you want
mm-hmm.
if you apply yourself.
Yeah.
Keep your nose out of trouble. Mm-hmm. You know, don't do stupid, you know. But, you know, they listen. No, they never listen.
Mm-hmm.
So how do we get the kids to listen? And the, you know, or is it, how do we get parents to reinforce values that will have kids, you know, listen and be attentive when they hear, you know, something from an elder or somebody that's their senior, and they respect the information that's getting in, then maybe it'll become knowledge, maybe it mm-hmm. won't, but they will receive the information,
mm-hmm.
you know, and analyze it.
Right.
And I think that's pretty much a big problem.
Right. You know, and you got to clean the mother-father figure up. You know, you got to clean that first family dynamic, because that kid is going to do whatever. And, you know, and the child is a being itself, and it will have its own considerations, right. You know. But for the most part, you can surely give it a healthy start by everybody, you know, in the family unit, you know, trying to work together instead of fighting all the time.
Right. Mm-hmm. Because when you talk about prisons and the crime rate and all that, I mean, people just don't start committing crimes.
Yeah.
They don't. You don't wake up one day and you're like, you know what, I'm going to rob banks. I think I'm going to go buy some crack and double up on this corner right here because that's a, you know.
I don't know. Give it a rip, man.
They don't. You fall into that through your associates, sometimes people you're related to.
People you're around, man. With,
like, you know, and you fall into that. The only thing that'll keep you out of that and keep your head straight is, what do I got up here that's making me intelligent enough to analyze this and realize it's not a good idea?
Mm-hmm.
It's a learned behavior.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Everything we do in life is learned behavior.
So. What was it, higher learning? And then it was like unlearned.
Unlearned.
I think we have a lot of unlearning to do.
Absolutely, man. Yeah. I mean, if we sit there and watch TV, I mean, I watched it and I'm like, are you serious?
Oh.
Are you, I mean, really? It's not that I have anything against TV, because I don't. I think it's cool. You know, Joker, the reality programs and all that. I'm like, I don't watch it. I'll turn it on. I have nothing against a movie. Watching like a movie.
Oh yeah.
I mean, that's cool.
It's a story.
Right. Mm-hmm. But when I'm watching this stuff, I'm like,
Honey Boo Boo.
I ain't know about that.
You never saw that?
No, I do not know about. I do not know about Honey Boo Boo.
Oh my god. Oh my god.
I've only heard.
Paid to be on TV. And I mean, they're pretty much trailer trash. I'll say it. It's like, you don't have to be anything to be on TV these days. Like, you can be, they got
Agreed.
The one cats, they're like, it seems like the more ignorant you are, the more Hollywood appeal you have.
Exactly.
It's like, you have to be, like, dumbed down and just, like, no kind of class. Oh, we got a spot for you on VH1.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I mean,
ratings.
But why do,
it is
why
too.
Do people... But I figured that out, too.
Go ahead.
I analyzed the hell out of this, and I was like, why do people like reality TV? Because I'm not going to lie. I'm all about the... I'm not going to stunt. Jersey Shore, I was hungover, and I was just laying there, and I was, like, flipping through the channels, and they had, like, this Jersey Shore marathon. And I was like, I'm going to see what the big deal is.
Yeah.
And I swear, I could not stop. It was like watching a train wreck. I could not stop watching it. I'm like, I gotta see what this retarded girl's gonna do next. You see, they have, like, they're so clueless. You're just wondering, you're just waiting for them to wander in the street and get hit by a car or something. Like,
right.
It's like, but then you, as a viewer, that's what we
that's
we
what
see people that are stupider than us. That's what we want.
Drama.
Because we want to feel better about ourselves. For real.
Well, just know that you're better than that. And if you watch Jersey Shore too much, Joker, your IQ goes down five points, man.
It does.
Yeah, I'm serious.
It does. I don't know. I'm like, teenagers like this?
Dude.
Like, I think when I was a teenager, this wouldn't entertain me.
You'd be like, what? And
we were out doing that stuff. Like, we
It
were,
wasn't going. I mean, yeah. But... Like this, when I first saw Jackass, the movie, I'm like, who is going to sit here and watch, and if I can, who's going to sit and
That's
watch a guy
example.
Put a bottle rocket up his butt,
then
light it, and then guess what? These kids are watching it, and they're going out, and they're doing the same stupid...
I'm gonna put a bottle rocket in my butt.
Come on, man.
There's nothing, not even...
You're more intelligent than that.
Level, there's nothing... tangible, like, you can't extrapolate any tangible data from doing anything like that. There's nothing scientific. I'm gonna put a bottle rocket in my ass and I'm gonna light it.
One right.
That is. That
I did watch faithfully was Keep with the Kardashians.
Oh, he did watch
what?
A Kardashian.
You know why I watched that show though? Because there's a lot of successful people, and you have to learn. Like, if you see something that you're like, okay, if you want to be rich, right? A lot of people are like, you get money. And it's like, yeah, but how do you get the money?
That's all they do.
You have to study people that are successful.
Amen.
You can gain something from that show. You can see how, you know, they try different business ventures and they and how they apply certain things. You know, and there's some science there. You can
absolutely
you can get data from that.
You can.
But Jackass,
no.
Jersey Shore, no.
No, and here's the thing on that. And I'm huge into the law of attraction. And it, the law of attraction, you know the law of attraction. Rhonda Byrne, Bob Proctor, all the guys, man. Bob Doyle, all those guys, right? So if I'm thinking to myself, and I'm just going to put an example out, man, look at all these bills. Man, I don't want all these bills, man. Look at these. Well, what am I thinking about? Bills.
Exactly.
Even though I don't want the bills, I'm thinking about bills. I'm going to get bills, right?
You're going to get bills.
Okay, cool. So now, boy, I like money. It's good to have it. I can help other people out with it. I got a lot of money, man. Yeah, and you just keep that thought in front of your face. But you start watching Jackass, you start watching Jersey Shore, guess what's getting pumped into your head? Law of attraction, man.
Idiocracy.
There you go.
That is...
Bam!
Have you seen that movie, Idiocracy?
I have not.
That is, it's a good movie. It's actually...
But I know what you're talking about.
I can see it happening because in this movie, pretty much there was a breakdown in DNA or something like that. I can't remember exactly that, but people were like stupid in the future.
Okay.
Like, I mean, really dumb. And there was this like no common sense, and this guy accidentally traveled back due to some like military time or something like that, and got into the future, and he was smart. And they were like, he's smart, like, and they wanted him to do everything, and it was just like,
yeah,
we're gonna be there in about 1,000 years if we don't destroy ourselves first, you know.
Let's not do that.
I mean, you can't find TV. We actually talked about this yesterday in class. There's a Blues, it's not Blues Clues, but it's a spinoff of that.
Mm-hmm.
And they were, oh yeah, because somebody wrote a thesis on how lifestyles are over-portrayed and kids are learning, like most kids don't need to learn how to milk a cow. Like, why are you a farmer's life, you know?
Right.
And like they're showing the milk from the cow, and it's like, it's and the point the author was trying to make was this is useless information for most kids,
mm-hmm.
because 98% of them are not going to be farmers.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, that's a hard job to have now. If you're
absolutely, it's always been awesome. A hard job. That yeah,
some cutting edge innovation that with your crops. But
man, more power to the farmers. That's dude, that's work, bro. That's oh man.
But there's also yeah, like I've noticed. I don't know what they do to these programs. But when they're on, especially my twins, they'll stand at Brenna. You can sit her. You, I mean, like you said, like the, I think there might be some kind of signal in the, because they're mesmerized by it.
Yeah, man.
They cannot take their eyes off of it. They're, and I think, and it make then it makes it easier for the parent to become lackadaisical with that.
Absolutely, we'll let them have it
with that kid, mm-hmm. and it just becomes like, oh, I'll let them watch it for an hour,
mm-hmm.
or then I'll let them watch it. Then you figure out you can do whatever the hell you want while your kids watch.
While you're watching that
and then
TV,
you never spend time with them.
And that kid's know? Getting brainwashed wherever that TV exactly. whatever that producer wants to put in that kid's
exactly.
head. Yeah, here it comes.
Exactly.
You know,
I mean, so just the dynamics of the whole family. How can we get a roadmap, or how can we get people more aware, because they got family counseling. I mean, you're mm-hmm. you're a therapist. You,
absolutely.
I mean, there is a dire need
and that's,
for that kind of, you know, structure and that kind of counseling. But
that's why I started it, man. I mean, it's like I'm only one person, you know, but I do not want to see society keep doing what it's doing. I just don't, you know. So I'm going to stand up. I'm only one guy. I get my nose bloodied, you know, a few times just by standing up, but I got to try to make the planet better because I'm on it too, you know. And so are you guys. I want my friends
and
safe.
And that's what I mean, I'll tell you right now, there are some people, when I told my son's mom about this show,
mm-hmm.
she was like, well, I'm going to have to watch it first. Okay. That's how much she trusts my intelligence and my aspirations in the world. Like she, you know, but when I met her in the 90s, late 90s, you know, I ran the streets. I sold dope. I did, you know, I was a gangster. I, you know, and that was my life. I sat around here and that's all I did,
mm-hmm.
you know, and that's all she's seen me do is
right.
like illegal activity. She's never seen me do anything positive. So why would I have feelings about her wanting to, you know, it's me checking myself before I get offended
mm-hmm.
because I know of all the, I know what I do,
mm-hmm.
but I don't, you know, broadcast it. you know, to people, because that's not why I do it, though. But, you know, when you change, it doesn't mean people's opinion, unless they actively, or see you actively changing.
They got to see the fruits of it, Joker.
Exactly.
They got to see the fruits, baby. Mm-hmm. Well, you know?
But people are like, Joker's doing a radio talk show on positive stuff? Mm-hmm. How did that happen?
Because he probably saw the light, you know what I'm saying? He saw what society was doing. I'm just saying, I don't know. But I'm just saying, he saw what society's doing, and it's like, oh my God, you know?
I think if you recognize a problem, and you're intelligent enough to bring some light to it, and maybe bring a solution, mm-hmm. and you do nothing, you're killing your kids.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
I mean, literally, you're killing them. Because a lot of people don't have the gift of, you know, innovation and imaginative thought and be able to, like, organize ideas to where it can help. So, like, people have ideas, but they don't know how to, you know, apply them to where they would do some good.
Right.
Everybody has good ideas.
Absolutely.
I don't mean it's going to happen. You know,
you got to stand up.
You got to stand up, man. You know, I think that's going to be a new campaign for the citizen movement. Stand up, unlearn.
Stand up and learn?
Unlearn?
All right.
Unlearn.
All right.
And learn.
Mm-hmm. Unlearn, stand up, learn.
Or how about stand up and deprogram?
Right.
You know? Because that's what's up, you know?
I mean, I discipline myself with what I watch on TV. If mm-hmm. I watch TV all day, it's mm-hmm. something educational. It's something that I'm lacking some information that I need mm-hmm. to make me better. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, I mean, if I want to, I love PS3, mm-hmm. not going to lie, gaming is fun, it's awesome, and I don't see a problem with, you know, if you're old enough and mature enough in the mind to know that, you know, you can be in this first person shooter and raise hell and destroy the whole city and just do whatever you want, be a maniac, but you don't take that outside with you.
You know, that's complete fantasy.
Right. You
that's
know
That's all it is.
And that's why you go in so hard at it. You're like, I'm just going to kill everybody because it's fantasy, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. But, you know, kids play these games when they start playing them when they're like 7, 8,
mm-hmm.
you know. There was a kid that played Grand Theft Auto better than me. I'm like, what the hell? You're like 7 years old.
Mm-hmm.
How do you even know how to play this game?
I believe it.
Like, what?
Give that little kid a guitar. There's a little...
Exactly.
There's a little Japanese kid, man, and he was... playing Crazy Train with Ozzy in front of like 80,000 people, and he was nailing it, you know. And he's like, what, 7? That's what's up, man. It's like, that's phenomenal.
When I'd rather Beethoven see him write his first thing when he was like 12.
He was young. I'm not sure.
You know, it was, yeah, he was, I mean, you know, 12 years old now. You know what I'm saying? Like, what happened to that? And these kids are actually smarter than they get smarter. They're not getting dumber.
Nope.
But we're just making them dumb by what we.
What we're pumping into them.
Yeah, we're putting them in front of their face. It's like,
mm-hmm.
there was this, I was dating this one chick one time. She had a son, and this was like the saddest situation. I mean, it's like the worst case scenario. This kid, and I mean, this was, you know, he saw us doing our thing, you know, because I knew a lot of his uncles, stuff like that. And he literally was, you know, he was like a little gangster. When he would go out and play guns, he would tuck his gun just like, I mean, he literally, everything that we, you know, that he saw us do.
You're taking that winning balance right there, baby.
And that's
what's
up.
I
was never comfortable with kids, but if it's not my kid, I'm not going to say anything, because, you know, we need to start saying stuff.
You got
to
stand up, man. You go, hey.
But back then, when I was in my mind state, I'm like, that ain't my kid.
Right.
You know, he's cool and everything like that. And I actually, you know, was like, maybe he'll work for me one day or something. Like, I mean, I was in it to win it. Like, I mean.
That is messed up, Joker. I mean, I'm going to let you know that right now.
It's got to be said, because if I can go from that kind of mind state to this mind state, you know, and recognizing all of that behavior was unacceptable.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it takes growth. I mean, that's growth.
Well, yeah.
And that's seeking knowledge, too, Joker. Big time.
I mean, I didn't want to do this show and everybody think I was, like, trying to be, and I ain't never did nothing wrong.
We all have, man.
Right.
We all have.
I mean, it's take what you know is wrong with you or what's been wrong with you, analyze it. If you can't fix it yourself, go see Steve Lindsay.
Love you.
he'll help you.
Yeah. And you learn from it and get the lesson.
You gotta, a lot of it has to do with, I don't know what it is with the, like medications and stuff like that. They
oh,
kids
oh man. We can open up that one if you want.
They have ADD. They have ADD.
Give them this. Give them that.
I hate that. You know why he has ADD? Because he has an iPad, a PS3, a Game Boy. There's that big screen. And then there, are you kidding me? How the hell are you supposed to concentrate these days? I can hardly concentrate. If I was a kid, you could have said I had ADD. But I mean, kids are supposed to be curious. They're supposed to be.
And they will be. Yeah. Absolutely,
I think,
man.
Obviously, if they have ADD, whatever they're doing is not interesting enough for them.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah.
You know, challenge them.
Mm-hmm.
Get them,
here we go.
I hate that. I hate the fact that they diagnose these kids today with all these,
It's a metal straitjacket, and it's control.
And it's all about money.
Do you think the pharmaceutical companies actually wants to cure you?
Hell no.
No, you don't, pharmaceutical company. You don't. You want to keep them more trapped so you can keep them addicted to that stuff, and you got walking zombies, man. That's what's up.
Okay.
And
go ahead.
Okay, so, everybody gets scattered.
Yeah.
Everybody gets scattered. We do, the kids. So if I say, a cycle of action, and all it is start, change, and stop, right? So I'm going to take this coffee cup, for those of you who are watching on the internet, and I'm going to move it from this point to the paper. So I'm going to start, change, stop. That's one cycle of action, right? So you would do one cycle of action at a time. When you give a kid this, and people do this all the time, hey, Bobby, move that flashlight. Bobby, grab me that coffee. Bobby, go talk to your uncle. Bobby, he gets so scattered because he's got like 20 cycles going at one time. One cycle of action at a time. Start, change, stop. Go to the next one. I'm going to move this coffee cup. Start, change, stop. Now I'm going to move that flashlight. Start, change, stop. Now I'm going to talk to Joker.
It's all about forming that process in your head, you're able to break down things into processes.
Yeah, absolutely. And
overanalyze. It's down to the atom.
Yeah.
And it doesn't have to be that.
To the nucleus of the atom.
That's just one of my character defects, though, is over just being analytical and everything. But.
So.
The pharmacy. This is what kills me about. This is what. The drug war, right?
Man, I'm
telling you. Drug war. Reagan. And Nancy Reagan and Ronald Reagan, and they thought this is drug war now, and Bush Senior, and they were like, which they were had to do with that Freeway Ricky Ross, bringing in cocaine from South America to fund, they call it drugs. They're like, drugs are bad. Now they want to give you drugs.
Absolutely.
They want to give you drugs. They're shopping to you. They're like, dude, buy these drugs.
It's
brain right.
It's control. Yeah,
exactly.
It's absolute control, man.
And how come you see it every, you see how they make the commercial? If you know marketing, it's sick.
When they let go of the side effects?
Because whenever they list the side effects, what's going on in the commercial? Pleasantness. And, people look like they're having the most awesome time in their life. They're like, side effects could include stroke, death, suicidal tendency.
But the sun's coming out.
Yeah,
so
but
it's
the sun's
cool.
Out. This dude's looking at the perfect sunrise. His wife,
but you might die,
son. Running in, they're hugging, they're going out to breakfast, and everything's hunky-dory.
It's foolish and it's sick.
It's sick.
It's absolutely sick. And, when clients come in to me, I got to get them off that stuff because, I really can't give them. We really can't get to the root issue when they got all this junk that the pharmaceutical companies want to keep them on, like Prozac. Oh my, trying to get through that stuff. It's like, but we can get them off it, man. I mean, it's a process, but we get them off that stuff and free them up because that's what they want, man. Yes, Joker, they are drug pushers.
Yeah, and I mean, they used to want to indict people like me back in the day, And on a scale of damage, we weren't even doing a drop in the bucket. How many people have died? One of my best friends lost his fiance. Overdose. It's like these drugs are way more dangerous than any street drug.
Absolutely.
I've ever ingested, sold, or any. Like, it, they are. I haven't heard somebody overdosing on, like, even like shit, cocaine or heroin. I haven't heard of that in a long time.
A long time, yeah.
I heard people like, yeah, he was drinking and took pills at night, and then they die. Like, right. It slows their heart that rate down so much, right. They fall asleep. It's like, they're, like, the heart just like,
yeah.
I'm stopping.
Yeah.
And then they die in their sleep.
Right. So you would have something like this, too. You'd have, like, the child, you know, or the person, whoever it is, has depression, and they go, well, take this pill, and side effects might include suicide.
Right.
Real, come on, man. It's, we're like, trying to go the other way.
Yeah.
We're going the other way.
To make you better, make
we're
you
going away
suicide.
From death, like, not towards death. Away.
That's like, if you want to shoot somebody, you point the gun this way and pull the trigger.
Right?
Side effects could include death.
It could include death. Permanent maiming of the body.
Oh, man. I love it. It's pure irony.
It really is. And you know what? People just need to become aware. They just do. And that's what the parents need
exactly.
to become aware.
And I hate, like, they. My son takes a, I mean, that's one of the things we disagree on, is the medication. Mm-hmm. But it does kind of, he is a little, it seems like he is more focused, but at the same time, he is not like lively.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he's just like real toned down. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Well, yeah.
And I'm like, that doesn't look like fun.
Nope.
You know, I mean, kids should be raising hell. They should be having fun. I mean, that's why you're a
thing.
Child.
Yeah,
you know?
Kids are,
I mean,
supposed to do their thing.
And then they,
man,
call it growing up, because then you don't, you know, do all the wild, you know, and you're not reckless, and you're, you know, I mean.
I'm against it, too, because my son, he's on the same thing.
Is he?
And it's just like, you know, you have, I mean, he bounced off the walls and stuff. I'm like, okay, I was a kid once, too.
Yeah.
You know, I was bouncing off the walls, too. But then you get one night, it's like, damn.
It's I bet if you played a couple games of basketball with him or something like that, it'll be like, let's go running. Let's go, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Let's go hiking. Straight up. I know some trails. Man, give me the most hyperactive kid. His ass will be taking a nap.
That's what's
by
up,
2 p.m.,
man.
You know what I'm saying?
Get him out.
I mean, that's what it is. These kids,
it's a mental straitjacket.
All the
is what
sugars.
I agree.
You know, you got the fructose, the sucrose. That's just, they basically base everything, high fructose corn syrup is in everything. And all, it's basically sugar. I mean,
well, don't eat artificial crap. Just start eating good food. I mean,
right. And that too.
That's
a lot
it.
Of it. I've noticed the diet of kids, and that's, you know what, that has a lot to do. I didn't even really think about that when I was doing this, but
oh, absolutely, Joker.
Like,
food, man, healthy
what
food.
The natural diet of a human being is, and what kids are ingesting, and what a lot of adults are ingesting too. But the kids don't have a choice though, because they don't have jobs, they can't go shopping, you know. Mm-hmm. But they can make conscious. They can be aware that, you know, eating all these oatmeal cream pies and drinking this Kool-Aid and then eating a candy bar and these chips at 3 p.m. right before dinner, probably not a good
exactly,
idea.
Exactly, dude.
You know,
why are you,
man,
so hyper? What's wrong with you,
yeah,
Timmy?
You
stop running around.
You eat half your dinner. You don't eat any of your vegetables.
Take this pill. Amen, man.
Like, my
really?
Mom was,
yeah.
My mom was awesome for that. Like,
yeah,
she made sure that we had a balanced meal.
Yeah.
A lot of the cats that I grew up with actually had, like, our moms cooked dinner and we had vegetables.
That's what's,
you know,
up.
And I think that is important.
It's massive.
Your body's a machine.
Right.
Your brain's a computer.
Shit, what is vegetables to kids?
Right?
Green and
I'm not eating that.
Yeah. Man, I love salad. Salad is,
and he's
fine.
Right, man. But what are vegetables?
Right.
Well, Timmy, a long time ago.
A long time ago. It's these green things.
Right. Like, what the hell is a vegetable, you know? 95% of kids
I got some nutritionist joker. We'll bring her in. She's phenomenal.
Oh, you?
Oh, gosh.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, that's good, because, I mean, that's some of the, you know, I think that's important information that
it's massive.
Citizens need to be aware of that. And it totally changes you.
And
if you feel like crap every day,
mm-hmm,
look at your diet.
Absolutely.
Look at your diet. you can, we have, you know, what's funny is we have all this technology, we have the internet, we have access to all this information, and we're so ignorant. We realize, I mean, I still forget that I have Google on my phone, and I'll come across something, I'll be like, I wonder if I can do, I can do some research. Oh, shit, I can Google it.
Yeah, Google it right now.
Google it.
Information like, at your fingertips,
man. You know how much, I mean, I got libraries of stuff.
Yeah.
Right. And this is, I mean, if we had that, when I wish, man, I was, you know, I probably would have been way better in school. Mm-hmm. I know we got ACE reports. Let me go research. You had to go to the library and get like 4 or 5 books, sit there all day. Man, that was whack.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, true.
But you had to get up and do stuff. And that's another thing. Kids don't really get, they don't have to get up really. They get a phone when they're, what, 12, 13? Yeah.
iPad.
Right.
They don't even... The future, we're not going to have... Our fingers are going to be... We might lose our opposable... Well, we need our opposable thumbs. We might have 2 opposable thumbs.
Right.
And longer fingers.
Longer fingers.
We're not going to have any... We're not going to need voices anymore because we're going to be texting everything and typing it.
You know?
Yeah. Oh, no. We'll have, like, super reinforced wrists.
Right.
We'll be all gangly looking.
Right.
Typing and doing... Yeah.
There'll be a word for him. Ooh, what is that? Oh, that's a texter. Like, here he comes. What, watch out.
I mean, we like that kid dribbling the basketball down the street. Or
yeah, just what I saw.
That was awesome.
That was very cool.
He, I mean, it was. You know, he was overweight.
He was doing his thing.
But he was doing his thing. And he was actually good. I was watching. You know, he had handles. Mm. And I'm like, you know what? And that's what I'm saying. Where did that positive reinforcement come from? It had to come from somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, and whoever it came from, they're doing their job. I mean, that's what people need to be doing. Because kids' self-esteem, like, you get people kill themselves over to Facebook. Like, and, like, there's not really a, you know, just that sense. I mean, I was so hard-headed. I was depressed as, like, I wasn't, you know, it was kind of awkward for me, you know, at school at times because I never really fit into any crowd.
Mm-hmm.
Because I wasn't a trend set. I wasn't a trend follower.
Right.
I had my own style. I did things how I did it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but I never really, I mean, I think every kid thinks about what it'd be like if they were not here at least a few times during, I mean, that's with all the, you know, your brain's doing some crazy shit.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, there is no way. I don't know. Maybe I'm just not, you know, a teenager with Facebook and know how it impacts my world.
Yeah.
Because everybody sees what's on Facebook. You get embarrassed.
You get invalidated. You get dominated. You get, I mean, you get like.
Everybody you know.
I'm hip. And it's like this, Joker. So you get one person, right, that. And more than likely, it's not true on Facebook. So this guy made up this thing about this person.
Right.
And then like 80 people took the other guy's side, the guy who's suppressing the other guy. And the dude takes himself out.
Right.
Because this jerk, right, got all these people on his side to agree with him about something, true
exactly.
or not. And they just hammered him. And guess what?
And now, what's that? What's the kid? He can't. Where's he gonna go? He like everybody he knows is on Facebook.
Right.
Like your whole
high school, you know.
Man, high school was hard enough, and junior high was hard enough.
Right.
Without that kind of crap complicating it, social Absolutely. Networking sites and
Absolutely.
Everything like that. I mean, man, I probably would have had a way more terrible time. I don't know. Maybe I would have been one of the cats. I mean, it's because. When I think about what used to be important to me, you know, when you're a teenager and you're like, oh, man, I remember I've had bad haircuts. Mm-hmm. I had bad choices in my attire for the day and got clowned for it, though.
Straight up. Right.
You know, but right. I'm thinking if that was
that happened. Me too, man.
But, okay. But now it's today, though.
Yeah.
And the same thing happens, like, shh. And then now it's on Twitter, Facebook,
MySpace. Oh, right.
Instagram.
You know, dogging you.
Right. And look what Joker was wearing.
I know.
Yeah. Man, oh, man. And the guy's in China going, Joker, you wore that today, man?
Yeah.
It's like, man.
In a teenager's mind, it's like your world just came crashing
Absolutely.
Down.
Absolutely.
And killing yourself sounds like a good idea. But you get to be 20, and you're like, damn, the stuff that I cared about when I was 15 or 16 Like, I don't even talk to any of these people from my high school. I don't even, they're not even important in my life. Dude, they have nothing to do with my success. They have nothing to do with my family, with my kids, or anything. Mm-hmm. So why was I ever worried about it? Mm-hmm. And the stuff that I was worried about then, you know, I was always worried about, you know, how can I hold the block down? I gotta, you know, this is my turf. This is like, right. it was just so important that I asserted myself in that fashion mm-hmm. that it totally, you've been read, what's going on?
What it do?
Just a mindset. It's a mindset at that age.
Now I'm at the age I am now. I'm 34. I'm like, man, almost everything that I thought was important before is absolutely not.
Cool. You're growing, man. That's what's up. Bang.
Like I said earlier, and I was like, if I could go from like going from due south to due north, how can we get people to do that?
Good, man.
It's Cuban Red. EOM.
There he is. Cuban, how you doing, buddy?
How you doing? All right.
Yeah, and you're right.
Yeah, you're actually right on time because we're about to go into the second hour. But yeah.
So
we can wrap this up with another couple of minutes, though, because I want to still talk about that. I mean, the how we can unlearn and then start, because once you start unlearning, then you can, you know, start learning.
Absolutely. You know, and it's not everything out there as we've been taught is bad, but the more program that we got, and just like we were talking earlier, you guys, on the Kardashians, you were talking about Jersey Shore, you know, you talk with Jackass, those shows, that's the stuff we don't need, you know. Right. We don't need that, man. Just give me something good, you know.
I don't even think it's funny, though. I'm like.
And me either.
Like.
Let me see Victor Wooten on a bass line, right, and watch him do his thing on the bass, man. You know, a little educate myself on the bass if that's what I like, that kind of stuff, you know.
I like the, they got the show Wipeout. I mean,
yeah,
that's an entertainment.
No, I think Wipeout's cool because that is like the guy's trying to do this obstacle course, right?
Yeah.
Right. So it's,
you got to be like a ninja. To be like, if you go through that course and you don't get messed up, you're a ninja.
You're a ninja. Yeah,
you're a ninja. You're a certified ninja. Yeah, you are. Jordan Vendetti standards, you are a ninja.
Splash.
Yeah.
Oh, I never watched, but that's another show, and I'm like, so they got people diving?
Yeah.
Celebrities?
Mm-hmm.
That's the whole gist of the show.
Yeah.
See, we'll watch anything.
Yeah.
We'll watch anything.
Well, you're hoping that he's going to land on his belly or his back, right?
Oh, Louis Anderson?
Louis Anderson.
And that's the whole thing. You're like, I want to see his big
exactly.
ass jump off
yeah.
into a big right. body of water.
Yeah.
But roll.
But
roll. He did. Did he?
Oh, he rolled and rolled back.
Wow.
Yeah.
See, and something inside me says, I want to see that.
That's what it was.
What is that?
Mm-hmm. You know, and not all entertainment's bad, but when we start, you know, like I said, getting, you know, and I'm going to go ahead and do it, say it again, people putting bottle rockets up their butt, you know, and letting the mom and dad, letting the kid watch that, you know, Jackass, and he's watching people put firecrackers, holding them on their hand, you know. Well, that hurt, and the kid's going to go out there. Don't. That's not the kind of stuff you want to watch, baby.
Yeah, and my son, he'd come over, he'd be like, he'd be on YouTube, and I had to kick him off.
Yep.
It's like, when you come over, just don't even get on your, like, go play a first-person shooter or something.
Right, exactly.
Like, damn.
You know? You'll be like,
I prefer that. Because everything that he watched and that he thinks is entertaining is so ignorant and stupid to me. And mm-hmm. I'm like, am I just being old? And I'm like, I don't think I am. Mm-hmm. I'm like, this doesn't nope. make any sense.
Yep.
I mean, this is it's stupidity. It's idiocracy. I don't condone that. And I, you know, and I told him that. I say, there's nothing valuable you can extrapolate from watching this. Right?
I understand.
Except, like, don't do it. But common sense should tell you, like, not to do it.
Some don't have it anymore,
right,
Joe.
You know? I mean, what did they think was going to happen when they did that?
Understood.
So where is the intelligence in that?
There's like, not.
Oh, that's going to be funny. I mean, we tell our kids to be sober and don't do drugs. These guys, as far as I've never heard any of the guys like ever doing any drugs. It's like, but they act retarded.
Mm-hmm.
Like they're on drugs.
Mm-hmm.
You tell your kids, you know, I mean, what do you expect of them? I mean,
it could go like this.
The models that they have where they find they're just, you know, they're these idiots.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you
say.
Like,
anybody
pop
the
Molly.
That's it, man.
That's what's hot.
Oh, man, I heard that song is hot, though. Yeah. Molly. But I remember when I first heard about Molly, I was like, the hell is that? And I was like, oh.
I never heard of Molly. What is Molly?
It's a pure MDMA, pretty much. Ecstasy.
Oh, is it ecstasy? Okay.
The main, from ecstasy, it's MDMA, and it's pretty much the chemical. So it's.
That's the one that you pick up at your veterinarian. I remember a while back for ecstasy, a vet store got robbed. And I'm like, or a vet clinic. And I'm like, why in the hell do you rob a vet clinic? Well, there's ecstasy. Who in the hell would have ever thought?
Wow. I'm like,
come on, man. That's society.
You can get formaldehyde out of mortuary. You know, that's like this. Stick cigarette in formaldehyde. Yeah, get me wet. And, and the mortuary will have like literally thousands of dollars worth of, that product in there.
I can just see some guy walking in and see like five vials, jackpot, psh, high five, right?
Shit, somebody just robbed the Walgreens, the pharmacy, grabbed all the hydrocodones, whatever like that.
That's what I'm talking about, Joker. We got to straighten up, man, as a society. And mom and dads, that's huge, bro.
It's huge.
That's massive.
And I forgot the dynamic of the grandmother, Big Mama.
That's huge, man.
She's gone. Yeah. She is gone. You know why? Because she's 30. She's 30 or 40 years old at the club. And that's what we have, if we have kids when we're young and we don't know anything, and we can't, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So then being a super reinforced role model, like Big Mama or a Papa,
mm-hmm.
It's, that came from just life experience and like, you just know stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Because you've just been around,
I mean, you was hard, Somebody was hard on you a little bit in your life.
Exactly.
Yeah?
And they whipped your ass because you needed that. It's kind of like they don't want you to spank your kids, right? But we have capital punishment.
Right.
They don't want you to, do all these things, but they have these prisons that are, like, if you're, okay, you can't be a pussy and go to prison.
Right.
At all. Like, you better dig down deep somewhere inside of you and pull your balls out because they will eat you alive in there. Like, so we will take advantage of you. Like, you are not in a good situation.
Right.
Like,
pull your balls out for you.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, I was going to say that too. Yeah,
right.
You were the.
Right. But we don't want to be tough on our kids. We want to be all, soft. Like, I mean,
even the death penalty, what I'm saying? Just talking about prison. You're saying you don't want to chastise your kids. You don't want to whoop your kids, but.
Yeah.
You wait till they get to a certain age, you throw them away in prison, give them a death sentence,
Exactly.
Kill them, what I'm
saying?
Yeah.
That's what I was saying earlier. I was like, if you recognize a situation that could be changed and you don't change it, you're killing your kids. They're going to get to that. Death sentence. They're going to get to that.
I grew up down south, right? Yeah. Atlanta, Georgia, Knoxville, Tennessee. And when one of my friends would mess up, old grandma would come out and say, do me a favor. He'd ask, what? He said, go pull me a switch off that tree.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Raise your hand if you had to get
your you said.
Thing
and you know what? And guess what?
Have you ever heard the word, go get the belt? And you try to go get the wimpiest belt. But if you were a little smart, you would have grabbed like a medium belt.
Because
you can't get the little, I had like this little cotton belt.
Yeah.
And then they get more pissed off.
Right.
It's like,
right.
So, and there's nothing wrong with corporal punishment whatsoever from the parent at all. When the child deserves it, because it's like this, and just like he was saying, that was a great point. By the time they get to prison, it's too late, Jack.
Mm-hmm.
You're going down.
Yeah.
Bob, we don't need you, and you're not helping society anymore.
Exactly.
You're hurting us as a human race. You're hurting us.
Exactly.
Hurting us. You have to go. We don't want them there, man. We want them productive, man.
Right.
Everybody helping out one another.
But then, I don't think they're completely unsavable at that point, but the battle's pretty much lost. Mm-hmm. If they're a young adult and they're lost like that and they haven't had any kind of, they don't have any positive reinforcement. They don't have
no roadmap.
They don't have a roadmap. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Their roadmap got burned a long time ago somewhere, mm-hmm. and they're just like,
mm-hmm.
Lost. I always feel like balance, the law of attraction and everything, but I believe in balance.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just like cops and robbers. If there were no robbers, we wouldn't need cops.
Mm.
I mean, we actually need ignorant people in the world so we can define it.
It's true. Good point.
We have to have, you have to, use something to make a scale out of. Like, yeah, that's kind of ignorant. That's really, that's just plain damn ignorant.
It'd be wonderful. It'd be wonderful if that wasn't even a word. And we're like, what ignorant? What's that?
Yeah, exactly. You know, what if we could just kill ignorance altogether?
Right. So on that corporal punishment we've talked about, and it's the same thing, Joker, where the child has got a fork, right?
Yeah.
And I don't know, maybe he's 3-4 years old, and he goes to put the fork in the thing. Don't do that. You're going to get shot, kiddo.
Right.
You're going to get hurt. And he keeps doing it. Well, there's going to be a happy hand across the butt.
Okay.
How we looking there, Joker?
I don't know. I don't think the CD burns it.
All right.
Yeah, let's wrap it up.
All right.
We're going to have to get back on this topic. I think, so would you be interested in being a permanent on this show? Just make it official.
You're asking me, Joker?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, man. Absolutely. Absolutely.
I think we're making real progress with the discussions we're having, and like, these are really important subjects.
Yeah, and they are. I can bring in some really cool guests, too. Yeah. I got some school teachers and all that kind of stuff. Bring them in. They've been on the front lines of going, man, you parents need to come on, man, because it's tough on me.
School teachers, it's weird. Like, they're on the same page as we are.
Yeah.
Like, man, these kids need to get their ass kicked.
Mm-hmm.
They need to be... Like, and then the way the Board of Education treats the teachers, like, they restrict the teachers so much.
Big time.
You know,
I got a cat.
Enforcement.
I got a cat up a MLK, man. He's up there, and man, he was so frustrated 2 years ago. He was like, Steve, man, and it's like, so he traded him into a class. But yeah, that student that was giving a lot of work, he finally got what he got coming. So.
Well, yeah, and you have a kid like that out there, and now he's in a classroom. The family structure was not there, the dynamic that was positive. So now he's unproductive.
Contagion of aberration.
Exactly. He's in this class, and now your kid can't learn because...
There you go.
This kid's in here distracting him or possibly influencing him, and your kid might think he's cool because he's a rebel, and then it could...
Contagion of aberration. Yeah.
I mean, that is... Yeah. And it's easy, especially when you're a kid. It's like... You know, you don't want to be, you know, enemies of the bully,
right?
You don't want to be like.
But you know what? And you got to stand up to that bully though.
I never
stand up to that bully.
That's why I had so much of a hard time in school. Because, I mean, I wasn't a big dude.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I didn't start growing until like ninth grade, really. Mm-hmm. You know, so I was always, but like the cats found out. It's like if you punch, I will punch you right in the face back. I know you're gonna kick my ass, but. Like, it ain't gonna be like this, like, bad. Like, it's gonna be a battle, dude.
Mm-hmm.
It's like
he won't come back a second time.
Right. Amen.
And I never held grudges either.
Mm-hmm.
The dude that used to bully me in junior high is my paper boy now.
Right on.
I mean, I see him all the time. Say what's up to him, you know, talk to him. And I could have, you know, held back some of their hate. I mean, actually, the first time I saw him, he was with his son.
Mm-hmm.
And I, you know, it's.
And hopefully, he didn't pick up the same traits that his daddy was doing.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, some kids help to slow you down, you know, and get you back on track. But there's some people who just, you know, they love that life, and they'll teach that life.
Yeah.
You know, and then once that child is so far gone, and then they finally want to try to snatch them back, once again, like you said, they're in prison.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
It's too late for that.
Yeah. And then there comes the big hand.
The big hand that'll smack you down.
Yeah.
And he'll never let go of you.
Yep.
You get, man, I had, you get a felony. Like, I just want to make this clear. That's, the best thing you can do as a young person is not get a felony.
Well, amen.
That thing will follow you through your life unless, even if you, because I tried to get a pardon for it. This was in 98, you know. Mm-hmm. I haven't really been in trouble since then, you know,
mm-hmm.
And my lawyer said I got pulled over and I had an open container,
mm-hmm.
and some weed,
mm-hmm.
and because of that they wouldn't pardon me from that felony.
Okay.
And he said you have to go another 10 years or something like that without being in any trouble at all. You know,
good. Don't
when
trouble.
You have a felony, you lose your right to bear arms. What does that mean? You can't protect your family. Mm-hmm. So what does that do? It puts you in a situation. So now you got to worry about, you know, and these are things that kids need to realize is like your life will be extra hard. Mm-hmm. People ain't gonna want to hire you, especially if you're. I could get a job wherever I wanted to. I was working at places that like grown people were working at, mm-hmm. and I get a job like that. Mm-hmm. Now, it was whatever after I got it, I was lucky if Burger King called me back.
Yeah, right.
They didn't even want. They're like, we got some people we can pay less, and they'll just
Yeah. So one of the rules for happy living is don't do anything illegal.
Right. And if you do, please straight be up. Smart about it. I mean, damn. You ever see World's Dumbest Criminals? And you're like, come on, brother. Like, really? come on, man. You see a dude try to break into somewhere and he just falls to the ceiling. And it's like, did you even analyze the situation before you?
Yeah,
I
popped the molly first.
Those are your drug addict criminals.
Goodness.
I'm a firm believer. And if you're going to, because I don't believe, because just because it's a law made by the U.S. government doesn't mean it's right.
So, but we're
saying that you should validate your own, if your family's starving and you rob a grocery store or something.
Les Miserables. You know, that's a show, right?
Where do you, is it right? Is it wrong? Do you let your family starve? Do you figure it out? Because it's not like you can, even if you got a job, you get a job. Sometimes you got to wait 3 weeks for that first paycheck, Your rent might be due. You might, you could be losing stuff. Mm-hmm. Then your family suffers. So then you take drastic measures. Mm-hmm. And then you'll get, then you might get caught. You get a felony. And then it just starts that whole, that's what I want people not to do.
Right.
Is to recognize, I call it foresight. And it works awesome for me, is you recognize exactly all the consequences when you see a situation and you're able to analyze it like that.
Joker, you need to go see Les Miserables. That's the same thing with Jean Valjean. Couldn't feed his family, took some bread, and it went. So it's a great show, man.
Yeah.
It's phenomenal. It's a Broadway show.
Yeah, it's a Broadway show.
Yeah. Oh, same thing.
I never saw it, but I've heard of it.
Yeah. The guy steals, man. He steals some bread to feed his family, and it's on. From there, it's ballistic. Great show. Yeah. How you looking on time there, Mr.
We're good.
Vendetti.
We're good. All right, we're gonna wrap it up. We'll see y'all next week. Just go ahead and start that first track up.
All right, Joker. It's been a pleasure, man.
Oh yeah, all the time. Yeah, Bird EOM, Cuban Red, Steve Lindsey.
Stop.
I'm Joker Vendetti, and we'll see y'all next week on Vendetti's Block.
Alright, now what's up with the CD?
No, that's right there.
Does it work?
Yeah, but what it did was, I need three more to burn the rest of it.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. It's good to have you. Introducing the legend itself, nonprofit prophet. The epitome representation of a citizen nation. Words encapsulate the many problems which we are facing. The engineer to the designer. The flame of the fire that forms a platform for citizens to elevate higher. The sound of the trumpet warning war has begun between the rebel aliens and the ignorant ones. Bring my fellow citizens to the plane that I'm from. Cause ignorance will leave your brain dead, same as a slug. A straight shooter focused like a laser, same as my gun. The epitome and summary of all the above. Bridging gaps like overpasses, hitch on bridging the matches. Breaking barriers and walls and threat your ball when it smashes. I'm a general, a captain, a lieutenant, and leader. Since following examples of my citizen senior. The pillars of wisdom, my professors and teachers. All citizens studious to progressive procedure. Now I carry the torch, a prophet, and preacher. Gatekeeper to the kingdom, ever told me St. Peter. Liberian savior, Luciferian Jesus. With the power to convert you by the end of this thesis. Heed the words of the written and will reflect your condition. Free your mind from any system, interjecting suspicion. Keep your logic and reasoning, common sense and your wisdom. The only tools you need to have when your adventure begins. Pay attention, citizens, to the words that I'm speaking. Every Sunday at 4 o'clock, it's real talk on Vendetti's Block.
Cuban Red.
What up, what up?
Bird.
What's going on?
You know. So, you want to give some past history on EOM and how you guys got together? What the business is?
Oh, yeah, we linked up, 2005?
Yeah, about five, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, man, you know, EOM consisted of three individuals at that point. So, it was me, Flame, and Cuban Red. Oh, and DeVell also. DeVell, he was a part of
it. Oh, yeah, DeVell, Chris?
Yes, sir, what we had going on. So,
Beast.
Yeah. For sure. So now we down to two, you know, just me and Cuban right now. So we just trying to keep things, you know, consistent and moving, and you know, our bond is, you know, over these years, is, you know, got really, really strong, you know, so we're just trying to pursue it.
Yeah, y'all been together a minute, a hot minute, dude. Like, I'm thinking hard because I think I met y'all a couple of years after. Actually, I remember the first time I met you was we were around there doing the shows at 120 Blonde. So yep. I think it was the Spotlight Club then, actually.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, sure was.
I'm big on it. And, yeah. I remember that was the first time I met you. It was on from there.
Yes, sir.
It was on from there.
Yeah, because our first show was with you, actually. That we did out in Wayne State.
Oh, yeah.
The
debacle of Wayne State. I call it that. It was an awesome show, but man, you know I made $30.
It was like wow. Six people.
Yeah, it was like as far as shows go, it was a disaster. Like a disaster. I mean, everybody had fun though.
Exactly.
Like, I mean, you know, so you know the shows. You know, if people don't make money, that's why I always tell cast that do this. It's like if you want to do this, don't do it for the money. If you want to do any kind of entertainment, don't do it for the money. Because that, yeah, man, because it takes so much time to, I mean, how long have you guys been rapping? Like, total, would you say?
I said I've been rapping for about 14 years now.
For real?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm about to say about 14 or 15 years, but like, professionally, it's been about 8 years.
Right. I mean, I told Castle when he's serious, it's like, man, it takes a lot of work. If you pay attention, like artists that come out, that's why, you know, now these artists that break out, I'm like, man, they didn't even put any work.
Real talk.
It's like, you know, T.I. rapper 10 years before his breakout album, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, people don't even know that he had his first album.
Real talk.
Sandman on it. He had that track that up. He had a video for it. I'm serious. And that's what it, you know, I was like, that dude's pretty tight.
Right.
And then I didn't hear anything. Then he just like blew up on that trap music. I was like, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but he put in work though. Exactly. I mean, right. Over if you look at the history of artists, how long it took them, it's like a decade. The average time is a decade of professionally doing it and then they get a break.
Yeah. I remember Mystical making a song called 13 Years. You know what I'm saying? He was talking about that whole concept. Yeah, so, just explaining it. Yeah.
But, we're close. We made our dues. I don't like.
Yeah. And at this point, I mean, that just, you know, and that's what I, you know, like to recollect to a lot of people, you know, just, I look at myself as a full-fledged professional at this point. Right. You know what I'm saying? I just got to make it be known. I just got to convince, you know, a million more people, you know what I'm saying, of the exact same thing. We got to, you know, be on our business, do everything right, you know what I'm saying? That's why we get everything going on, you know. Just did a photo shoot, you know. We're gonna eventually do a video, right. You know what I'm saying? Like,
video.
DJ Votto. Shout out to DJ Votto. Yeah.
Yes,
sir. Yeah. You know, we're just doing it big. 2013 is a big year for EOM, you know what I'm saying? And we've been, you know, we had to kind of watch ourselves for a second. You know, we kind of caught ourselves, you know, talking about all the whack artists and just all the bull, you know, BS, you know, going on around Omaha, you know what I'm saying, as far as the whole music scene. But we had to take a step back and realize that, you know, some people's grinds is just so much heavier than ours, you know what I'm saying? They just out there like that, and they deserve the attention they get, you know what
right,
I'm saying?
Right.
So until we can do the same thing and put ourselves out there the same way they have, even though we do feel like we're professional and been in the game for a while, you know, we got to just take a step back, you know what I'm saying? Man. Yeah.
I think everybody's been guilty of that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of people that hate on Hooligan and shit. I'm like...
Ah, yeah.
Grind
like,
is tight.
It, like,
you got to respect the dude's grind and how it is tenacity in the game.
Yeah.
Because that dude, he has that, you know, his marketing, like, he knows what he wants and he's doing.
Real
because
talk.
Like, has
yeah.
to take something from that.
Yeah.
You know, that's what we need to start doing is like, oh, man, I need to get my grind like that.
Right.
I need to get my marketing like shirts, yeah.
Right.
You know? And then, you know, collaborate with them.
And there's a few out here too, you know. Shout out to Bacon, you know, Bacon the Small Town, ASO, you know, Ill Child, you know, it's some out here, you know, Shy Shy.
Shy Shy,
yeah.
Yeah.
They got it going on, man.
Bo, you know what I mean? He's a marketing beast.
Yeah. King James.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When they have a project, you can see that there was time put into it.
Yeah.
Right.
Because you can rhyme, you can rip and you rhyme.
I know regular ass people that have like regular ass jobs that can rhyme, but they wouldn't call themselves rappers.
Right, we've been through that. I mean, even times on, you know, like being on, you know, Facebook or whatever, with people trying to, oh yeah, you know, I think my group will go hard in EOM, and it's like. What? It's like, you know, you a new nigga. You new to this. You know what I'm saying? You just started. We've been doing this shit forever, you know?
So it's like, why do people even take stabs like
right.
that?
Right. And then it was like
hey.
Hey, right. But you know what?
I mean, are you trying to go verse for verse on this? Oh, no. 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 That's not. No, I don't want to do that. Oh, okay. So why bring it up?
Welcome all contestants. Welcome all contestants.
Right. Right.
We welcome it all.
I never was really like the battling kind of rap or whatever like that, but just for the spirit of the occasion, you know, but it wasn't anything, you know, there was no hard feelings. It was more of a camaraderie. And I still remember that to this day. It's like, you know, everybody that's acted salty towards me though, I remember that too.
Exactly.
But I know why they're salty though. You know, if you're dope, you don't have to proclaim it.
Right. Right.
Facebook saying like, man, I think I'm one of the dopest lyricists that ever existed.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I mean, why would I say that? Even if it's true, even if, like, why would I say, just because I'm stabbing at everybody else in this city that knows that's doing this and that I partnered with or collab with or and not really giving them props, you know, on anything that might have helped, you know, mold my style or something. You know, I've learned a lot, you know, when you're recording. You know, the art of recording a song and spitting into a microphone in the booth is a skill that at least 80% of these cats out here don't have.
Exactly.
Voice inflection, like, using your diet, like, people that know what I'm talking about know what I'm talking about.
Exactly.
People that are like, what's that? Exactly. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's like the science behind that. I mean, I always look at the science behind it. I'm like, I figured out how I can make my voice sound, and if I wanted to be, and it's just second nature now. If I know my voice raises, I automatically go like this. It's crazy. Like, I'm just like, program. But like I say, you do it for so long, you become professional.
All day.
And you earn that.
All day.
You know, so when, you know, my cousin bashes me for, I'm really hard on new rappers. I'm real hard on them.
Yeah. Right.
Like, I'll tell them to their face, like, there's one cat, he was like, what you think of the show? I was like, constructive criticism before it is, but I believe if somebody's terrible at something, you shouldn't reinforce, like, them doing it.
Right, right.
Like, if you suck, just stop. Like, I don't see any hope for you doing this. Like, people on American Idol, and if people think Simon's a dickhead,
Oh, he's real.
He's for real, though.
Yeah, he's real.
And, like, whenever he's impressed with somebody, I'm like, they're going to be famous one day. Straight up. Because he liked them.
Right.
So, you know, you can...
Right, right.
But you got to have people like that. There's nobody here like that no more.
Shit, I mean...
There's got to be a standard.
Prime example was that show that you performed that Thursday, it was some people up there who it was kind of like, what the hell? You know, why are you even up there? You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, it was a lot of that. You know what I'm saying? But I ain't gonna knock nobody, but it was kind of like, damn, you know, like, really?
It just took a very long time to find the track that we actually liked. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's a better way to put it.
Took a very long time.
Very long. I mean, it was...
I've been real, like, I haven't done a lot of business at the IHOP because of that fact is, I think it has a reputation for being an amateur spot. That was the first place I actually performed at, you know? Mm. With,
when it was the Shea Riley's?
Shea Riley, you know, yeah. Like,
that was the first time I met Breathless. I mean, long ass time ago. And it's like, it seems like you could just be mediocre and perform there or book a show there. It's like there's no standard. Nobody is looking at that show as a product. Mm-hmm. And if it's actually then the artists that are involved, are they products? Are they brands? Are they people that are like serious about it? Or are they half-ass doing this and they got Pro Tools? And then a rumor they just recorded in the closet. I'm not knocking that, but that doesn't make you have a studio. That doesn't make you a rapper. Doesn't make you an artist. Like you say, it takes time to be an artist.
Right.
You're just whenever you're just doing it, all tough, you're just doing it. It's just something you do.
Right.
It's like a hobby.
I agree.
It's not like how we got it. Like it's a craft. It's an art.
Right.
It's something that we respect.
Exactly.
That we can, you know, we can pass knowledge about that to other people.
Right. Exactly.
So you should do this. Advise them. Like, you should do this. You should, you know, should be this close to the mic. You should, you know, make sure your voice isn't so overpowering because it makes it easier for the engineer to mix it. You know, make sure, you know, just like, and putting them on, you know?
Right. And if you ain't got a passion for it, I mean, you really shouldn't be doing it.
Exactly.
That's how I feel. I mean, I don't knock nobody who do it just to have fun with it, but it's like, you know, what you trying to get out of it? What's your point? You know what I'm saying? Like,
right.
What you trying to prove? You know, if you're going to do it, you know, do it because you love it. Like you said, I mean, don't just focus on doing it for the money. Because
right.
As long as we've been doing this, you know, nobody's, you know, really getting paper like that off just doing music.
Right.
You know.
That's a prime testament to that. Like, yeah. I spent so much, I mean, thousands upon thousands of, like, tens of thousands of dollars, actually, since the company started. And, like, it's, like, if I was on Wall Street, it wouldn't look good.
Right. Numbers. It's off.
But, I mean, but that's not my, you know, I have other skills to make money with.
Mm-hmm.
Music is not, you know, but music got me here in this seat doing this show. I never thought I was going to be doing this, you know, but it was an avenue to something else.
Right.
So even if you're, you know, keep your mind open while you're having all these experiences, because, man, you might run into you might be an actor in 3 years. Famous as hell.
Right.
From music, though, you met this movie producer, and he was like, I got this role, and then, you know, then, a super dope director sees it, and he's like, I want that guy for that role, your breakout role. You never know where life is going to take you. You just got to, like, dive in this shit, man. And, you know, if you're doing entertainment, because
mm-hmm.
I like to say that I'm an entertainer now.
Right.
Because, I mean, I'm getting the comedy and everything, because I realized that I actually... While I have my little rants and I be gurping about stuff,
right.
Like people think it's hilarious. I bring up valid points, but I just make it like the irony that I attach to it.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, people shouldn't like restrict themselves to, you know, kind of like what we were talking about earlier a little bit, just one path. Like you should always see, you know, like five, like you hold your hand out, those are your paths. Like, you're on this path right here, but this is your future. You have these options. You know what I'm saying?
That's a good way of saying it.
I mean, that's the, like...
I mean, kind of basically, like right now, you know, I've been working with Big Wave for a long time now. You know what I'm saying?
That dude has a passion for the music. He's a real, you know, he is a real artist. Like,
Right. It's pretty much nothing he cannot do. You know what I'm saying? He pretty much got it all. And... I've been making, you know what I'm saying, like the past, you know, what, about three beats, you know, we made pretty much together. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And it just, I never really thought I would end up doing nothing like that. I came to the studio one day, and he was just like, man, because I asked him, you know, he was supposed to make me a beat. So he was like, well, man, you know, I didn't get the chance to make it or whatever. He was like, but, you know, we can sit here and make one right now.
Right.
I'm like, wow, right now, you know.
If you got some creative people and you got some equipment and there's somebody that knows how to use it.
Right.
It doesn't take long at all to do anything.
I realized that.
That's Q Diddy over there. Q Diddy, man. He been
4 hours. I'm talking like making the beat, writing the lyrics, mixing and mastering. 4 hours.
Yeah. I mean, shoot.
So, yeah.
I
mean, that's what professionals do, though.
Exactly. You
know, what artists do. Professional artists. I mean, that's when I have. That's why I stopped doing, or I didn't stop. I never really did features.
Mm-hmm.
Because I did a couple, and I would go there, and I'm like, this is making me look terrible.
Well, depending on the artist you was working
then
with.
I figured out, I'm like, well, if I just get on every track and eat it up, they'll be like, who's that? Like, yeah, you sound pretty good. Then your verse comes in, and be like, damn, but who's that?
Right.
You know, so that's what I'm saying. Y'all cats out here need to quit hating it. I mean, collaborate. If you are the dopest, you'll get on anybody's album and eat it up. That's what I do.
And I mean, I'm glad you bring up that point, you know what I'm saying? Because that is a problem of EOMs, and it always have been, you know what I'm saying? Like, we love other artists. I always have, you know, love working with other artists, you know what I'm saying? But it's I don't know, Bird, what you think, man? It's kind of what's going on, man? Won't nobody get on our tracks, man? What's
I'm
up?
I'm not saying that, too. I mean,
you know what it is. I mean, you know.
I mean, we have both experience, you know, working with other artists or whatnot, and then performing shows, you know, with them, and we get more of the attention, you know, or something like that, and then everything else, you know, is kind of went like sour. That person's nowhere to be found no more. Right. Right. And it's like, we know, we just doing us. You know, we just doing us. This is what we do.
You guys are humble cats. That's what, like, attracted me to you guys as a group. My bits, I was like, you know, these cats are level-headed, and, you know, their egos are, you know.
Hey, shout out to Joker, too, because he right. Joker always did support EOM. He always did like EOM. So, yeah, shout out to Joker.
That first compilation that I wasn't able to put out, we all know the story behind that. We won't go there, though. But some of y'all producers need to quit being hate, like.
I remember that. Yeah. I sent them like what, two tracks? We had two tracks on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know what? I wasn't putting that compilation out to get rich. It was called The Showcase. I was like, this is Omaha. This is what's up. And I thought I found like a diverse, you know, group of cats and got tracks from them and put together a really good product.
Right.
And when this dude wants to talk about publishing and shit, look, we ain't in New York, we're not in LA, and this isn't like, you know, you're not, you know, Jermaine Dupri or something, dude. Like, you're not that dude.
Yeah. Exactly.
Like, you're good at what you do, and you're trying to be professional, but at the same time, it's not that deep. Like, what do you think, what are these two songs is going to book? And that's why you always have that panel anyway, and it's like, the publishing isn't, you know, it's like, just this compilation. I was like, I'm probably going to give it away anyway.
Right.
I'm like, why? And I mean, but he's like, he was going to sue me and all this. And I was like, let me not do it before this dude. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Hateful shit.
Yeah. And I'm like, for real, I'm going to punch people like that. It's like, dude, come on, man. It's like, you're just hating. And you want credit for something. And I never understood that. Why? Because if I buy a beat from somebody, I own it.
Exactly.
Like, you sold it to me.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Like, I own it. Like, period. But I've worked out deals with some cats publishing wise where it's like, you can get 25% of the ASCAP.
And
I'll pay you a lower rate or something like that. I'm like, how can we work it out to where, because I'm not going to give you $300 for a beat. I'm not even going to give you $100.
Right.
I've never paid for beats. Do you guys, didn't Flames used to produce a lot of your guys' tracks?
Right, yeah.
Yeah, he used to produce a lot of our tracks, too, because, you know, he was a part of EOM. So the beats, you know, from him, you know, yeah, they were free. But the beats that we did, you know, used for that Winter Heat album are currently being, you know, sold.
Solicited, you know what
right.
I'm saying?
So.
Right, so
I mean,
it just goes to goes to show exactly what you're talking about, far as producers, you know what I'm saying? I mean, at one point, you know, I ain't gonna even put the cat name out there, you know, but I had to wait 8 months to get a track back, to get mixed and mastered after I recorded it one time, you know what I'm saying?
And pay for it.
Just made me wonder what was the cat up to? What was he doing? You know what I'm saying? Right. Like, what were you doing? I mean, he did tell me, yeah, you this, you that, Cuban, you this, you that, you know what I'm saying? I think you got a chance, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, and that even made me further wonder, okay, well, what are you doing, man? Why did it take so long? You know what I'm saying? What are you trying to do? And right along with the beats, right. You know, trying to lease a beat to me, you know what I'm saying? Like, come on, dog, mm-hmm. Really, what is going on here? You know, I haven't worked with him ever since. Be honest, I would like to. I'm more mature. You know, I'm grown, you know what I'm saying, now. You know what I'm saying? That was a while ago.
Yeah.
Hopefully he can get on a good foot, you know what I'm saying, so we can get back, because he is talented.
Yeah.
But, you know what I'm saying, some of these producers just need to get it right.
I recall that.
There's a lot of talent. You know what? This is what I say about talent in Omaha. Real talk. Where that came from.
Right.
Around the corner, you're not special. You know what I'm saying?
I mean,
you can't think of one person in this city that's so exclusive that you're like, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it is a business. You have to look at yourself like, yeah, you're a brand. You're a product.
Right.
You have to market yourself right. You have to, you know, but you don't have to be a prick about it. You don't have to say, oh, man. Yeah, I could do a track for you. I'll be on it. You gotta give me like $150. So I'm like, why would I even do that? If something happened between yesterday and today, did you sign? And here's a perfect example. Stevie Stone. My guy hit me up. He said, yeah, you know who Stevie Stone is? I'm like, no. Because I didn't.
Mm-hmm.
And so I knew he had a song with Tech, you know, and he was on Ruthless Records, Eazy-E's old label.
Right.
And so I was like, okay, so he's got a little bit of clout in the game, whatever like that. But I was like, what's he charging? Like $300. And I'm putting this out here because, real, man, I told this other cat, because a cat visited me on Facebook. I was like, don't even waste your money, dude. Straight up. Because the shit I got back was weak. Straight up weak. I killed his verse, dude. I killed it. I was like, why am I paying somebody to be mediocre on my shit? This dude is not that dope. Straight up.
Yeah.
I don't care what anybody says. I'll put my flow against his any day.
Right, right.
I paid this cat to be on my shit. And he, it was like a terrible job. He called me, and first of all, after I picked it, took like a month, like, and I actually had to send it. It was like a semi, you know, it was abrasive, dude. I'm like, what's up, dog?
Right. What's the hold up?
Mixed up with Omaha,
man.
For $300,
yeah.
He'd be dogging me like that.
Right.
I'm like,
right.
What's up with the track? But he was on this little tour, or whatever, like that, and he was having the problem with getting it, you know. But I'm like, dude, if you've already been paid, provide the service.
Exactly.
Be a professional.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's not like he had a manager. I was going through somebody that was semi-professional. You know, I'm calling this nigga's cell phone, like, and sometimes he can answer. It's like, so I'm saying, basically, cats, save your money. Collaborate with these cats in the city that are doper than most of these commercial artists and all these other fools out there that's trying to, you know, pretty much get over.
I mean, and then one thing that I always looked at it as, you know what I'm saying? I don't understand why, you know, so many others don't see it this way. If you collaborate on, you know what I'm saying, with somebody, if they doper than you or not, regardless of all of that, when you put a track, you know what I'm saying, you do a track like Joker, me and you, we do a track together.
Yeah.
That's your fan base, you know what I'm saying, hearing you plus mine.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? The same vice versa. That's my fan base hearing that track plus yours. You know, you get some new fans, you know what I'm saying, out of some of mine once they hear the track that you're on, which
exactly.
Because I'm on it, you know what I'm saying,
exactly.
And vice versa. And right, that's a network, you know what I'm saying? And I believe that's how.
Absorbing when you, like, you, because that's what, you don't want to take over somebody's fan base, but you do want to absorb them.
Right, right.
Exactly.
You want to, okay, it's like, I mean, if you're, if that's what I want to say about cats, don't just, I mean, damn.
I mean, I would say probably the.
Too easy.
the best collab that I did pretty recent was for my album, The Four Horsemen, which was me, Cuban Red, El Genius, and Eternal from the West Coast Killer Bees. And it was on fire. You know what I'm saying? Everybody brought it. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, that's how you got to do it. You know, right. If you're going to do something, do it right. You know, everybody brought their A game on, you know, on that track.
I mean, it'd be nice to hear it, but but yeah, it's fire.
It is fire, you know. So, but you know, I mean, and hopefully, you know, everything will just come together, you know. So that's what it's all about.
Well, see, and see, plus this is the whole thing. Like, I did a collab with Bamboozle. And whenever he has a show, he wants me to come perform that song with him. That's dope.
As I should
I
be.
I don't have to do a whole set. I can literally absorb everybody that's there mm-hmm. that came for all these other people.
Right.
With one track.
Yeah, that's what exactly. I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about.
So if you do and you kill it, you don't even have to, you know what I'm saying, perform that, you know, 15-minute set where people might, you know, kind of, you know, there's kind of monotonous, this, that, you know what I mean? But you're fresh, you're right up there, and then you just blew their mind.
Right, right.
And they're like, I'm going to Google that dude. I'm going to check him on Facebook. You know, I mean, it's the art of war. Like, Sun Tzu is like, absorb these people.
Right.
Don't try to knock down somebody else's castle then live in them.
Man, real talk. Why would you even want to? Man, you decorated this. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, this ain't me. This ain't my style.
Man. Exactly. Yeah.
The artist information and talk about publishing and A&R and everything.
Yeah, I remember that.
It's all free. I used to charge for that. But I was like, you know what? Why, you know, if I could put some cats on some game, that'll get them, if they're talented, and they'll be able to, like, climb another step up just from that. And like, oh, so I can contact this company, you know, and they're like this now. You know what
right.
I'm saying? So. And then down the road, you know, I'm like, hey, do you have a manager? No, you should be a manager. You know,
uh-huh.
Straight up. They're going to want you to, they know you know your shit. You know what you're talking about. You
right.
know? And then, you know, they know you'll look out for their best interest no matter what.
You know.
And then you can start making money.
The thing talk, is, man. Though, is a lot of people, they don't want to share that information no more. You know, they don't want to help people. They don't want to open avenues. You know, I got, well, right now I'm working with a young woman, you know what I'm saying, who wants to do music. And so I'm sharing some of my knowledge with her. You know, I mean, she's pretty dope to, you know, just be starting to write music, you know, and I'm like, damn. So I was like, well, shit, I take her under my wing because she's pretty dope. So. You know, and I showed her certain things she can do to help improve her writing skills. And, you know, she already know how to count bars and all that shit. I'm like, damn. You know how to count bars? Yeah, I just figured it out. Like, you know, I was like, all right, cool. You know, that helps to.
That's hard for some people.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Right. So I was just like, well, damn. I mean, I guess the way I showed her how to write, because I put hashes in between how I do certain things. So you stay on, you know, you keep your rhythm. You know what I'm saying? And. She picked that up. And
I taught that technique to pretty much everybody I've run across that rap, if I have my lyrics, I'll show them exactly how, because I see them writing, I'm like, how do you rap that? Because that's what
right.
takes so long when you're getting the takes that it's like, alright, run it back. I lost it here.
Yep.
Because you don't even have any pacers in there.
Yeah,
exactly.
I do.
Like,
I'm
like,
I'll be
like, run
ways.
On sentences.
Like, yeah. Try to read a book.
Yeah.
Like you're rapping it. That's exactly what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Right.
It's almost impossible.
Yeah.
For me to do that, I can't do it.
Exactly.
Like,
I hate when somebody be like, "Hey, I want you to be on the hook. Here, read this. You know, spit this, nigga." Wow. What the fuck? You know, it's a random sentence.
Insert
I'm supposed to.
Here.
Right. You know what I'm saying?
But see, hey, that's a bit of how my style came about. You know what I'm saying? You know exactly what you're talking about. See, I used to draw, you know what I'm saying? Before I started rapping, I used to draw and play basketball. And one day I left my art, you know what I'm saying, my art book on a school bus. And, you know what I'm saying, one of my biggest competitors, you know, stole it. You know, he took it and ran home and, you know, took a couple pages out of it, you know what I'm saying, and brought it back, trying to act like he didn't steal it. So when I began to rap, you know what I'm saying, that taught me a lesson, you know what I'm saying? So I started writing in all kind of different ways to where I knew I felt like only I could understand, only I could rap it. Like, if right. you stole it, then, okay, you got the words, but you don't know what you're doing, you know what I'm saying? You don't know how to rap it. And then I just started forming all kind of different styles to where I just don't even know what my style is, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. I just do whatever, you know what
Let
I'm
that
saying?
Be known that Cuban did lose to me in a three-point contest.
So
I'm pretty sure he's upset about
come
that.
And on,
he does want his rematch. He has been talking stuff. He did beat me in his house on the full court.
44-8 44-8
The little hoops, we know we took it a little serious there, you know what I'm saying? A lot of sweat.
Hey, if he wasn't with it, man, he should have picked that ball up, man.
But yeah, I mean, you know, to get back on topic, you know, right now, so EOM right now is putting together some things as far as, you know, a mixtape right now with me and Cuban Red. We already have the Make Me Wanna Cheat single that's been, you know, killing the radio station right now on 106.9.
I've seen that.
Yes, sir. Also here, also too. So it's been going pretty strong. And Q Diddy, a.k.a. Cuban, did, you know, produced that beat, him and Wade. So shouts out to both of them on that. And then also working on my actual album, The Decision, with P Square Media, which does feature, once again, my guy Cuban Red. I got Eternal from West Coast Killer Bees on there. Serafina is on there. El Genius is on there. I mean, it's going to be a pretty hot album, too. So, you know, we're just trying to keep things moving.
You know who's not on
work.
There?
My guy. You know, me and Joker still got to link up, man, you know.
But you know what? I've noticed that about, because, like, El Genius' first two albums. And then I know a lot of cats that rap, and I've never been on the album. I was like, damn. But it's never really came up, like, as the why, because we know we make something real dope.
Exactly.
I don't know what it is.
Man, my thing, man, like...
I'm patient, though. I don't feel like I need to be on... You know, if I know somebody's coming out with an album, I'll be like, oh, man, you got to get me on that. Like, when I was recording the mixtape, the Rapping Assassin mixtape, I was like, oh, man, you should get me on a track on that. You should get me on a track on that. And I'm like, yeah, hey. Okay, but, you know. Maybe. Like...
I don't know, man. There's been times where, I mean, I've been in the studio and you walked in, and it just never did.
Damn,
I never.
Oh, it was probably on. So
it just never came up, man. Because you was, matter of fact, you came in there when I was recording the joint at G House, and it just never came up. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, we've been in the same. You know, on the same avenue, but it'll happen.
Like I said, I'm patient. I don't feel like I need to, you know, just, you know, it'll happen when it happens. I'm like thinking maybe it'll just be one track that I'm with all these cats that we never collabed and that we just do this really super dope track. That's and we're just saving it all for that. So we're going to wrap it up. Get to this mix. Thank y'all for coming down to the block.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
You know this is where I grew up, too.
Oh, really?
Near, yeah, we used to play basketball in this alley right here.
Like, wow.
It's crazy. It's crazy.
Mix me up, DJ Sway. DJ Suede.
Can't wait to taste your skin. Baby, no. And these eyes, can't wait to see your grin.
Suede.